So we moved on to the best paper award, and I should say best paper awards. So this year there were 3 best paper awards given. The first one is on simple proofs of sequential work by Brent Cohn and Christoph Bietertag. And Christoph will give the call.
Okay, welcome. So this is joint work with Bram Cohen, who is also somewhere here, so you can also ask there. So you can ask him if you have questions. So I will tell you something about a very simple result, simple proofs of sequential work. So here is the outline of the talk. I first will kind of define and motivate the problem, or just define the problem that you look at, the object you look at, proofs of sequential work. I will give you actually not just a sketch, I will actually show you the entire construction and almost the entire proof. And if there is time, I will also kind of tell you why we looked into this problem in the first place, namely sustainable logics. Okay. So what are proofs of sequential work? So let me make a detour. Like, you know, in the mid-90s, Rindus, Charmier, and Wagner initialized a field that is called time-release cryptography, and they constructed this object that is called a time-lock puzzle. And it's so simple that I can show you here what this thing was. So not surprisingly, it's something with RSA. The puzzle is simply RSA modulus n, some random group element x, and some time parameter t. Think of t as 2 to the 4, for example. And the solution to this puzzle is defined as x to the 2 to the t modulo n. Now, the puzzle generator knows the factorization of n can just compute this solution with 2 exponentiations, whereas it's conjectured that if you don't know the factorization, you just get n. You have to do t sequential computations or t squared on top of x to arrive at this solution of this puzzle. And if we kind of equate sequential computation with computation time, this is kind of a way to send the message to the future, right? Because it's really conjectured that you cannot speed up this computation even if you have massive parallelism. Not as massive that you can factorize, but you know, massive. Okay. So, then you know, nothing happened in this field of time-release crypto until like 2013, when Mahmoudi, Morad, and Ladan came up with this new object, the proof of the publicly verifiable proof of sequential work. Let me shortly compare what this object does compared to time-lock puzzles. First of all, it's much less ambitious. We don't want to send messages to the future. We just want a proof system where a prover can prove that he did some sequential computation. That's it. What was the motivation for this? The one application they had back then was non-interactive timestamps. So I'm on an island, I prove p is not equal to np. So then, you know, I hash this document and I start this this proof of this non-interactive proof of sequential work. And 20 years later, when you know I'm saved, p is not equal to np is known, but I can prove to you that you know I had it 20 years ago. So there is this sequential computation that they did. So it's an equal functionality, but on the other hand, they also kind of didn't require this weird non-standard algebraic assumption on RSA type assumption, but they really just did it in the Rath-Morath model. Or if you want the standard model assumption, they kind of showed that you can do this with, you know, collision-resistant hash functions and some other not quite standard assumptions called sequential hash functions that I will mention later. So much weaker assumptions. And another point that is very important also for us, and that also is emphasized in the title, it's called publicly verifiable proofs of sequential work. Their protocol is public common. So everybody can verify that the proof is incorrectly done, whereas if you want to do this proofs of sequential work based on this time-lock puzzle, there is no way how to do it, because you need the factorization to verify a proof, but if you have the factorization, you can also kind of solve the puzzle faster. So this public common thing is really. So how is this proof system defined? It's very simple. It's a verifier and a prover. The verifier samples some public random coins chi's. Let's call this a statement. He sends this over to the prover together with some time parameter, like 2 to the 40. The prover computes a proof and sends it back, and the verifier kind of runs some efficient verification algorithm and accepts or rejects. So how is completeness and security defined, as how it's defined of this thing. So I will only tell you how it's done in the Rath-Morath model, because this really simplifies things. So completeness simply says the prover should be able to verify, to compute an accepting proof, just making t queries to the Rath-Morath stage. That's it. Right? So that should always work. And security or soundness is defined as follows. If you challenge to the random, I shouldn't use Greek letters, I think. If you challenge with a random chi, then you should not be able to come up with any kind of accepting proof tau prime unless you make almost t sequential queries. Even if you kind of make queries in parallel, like building queries in parallel to the run more app, you should still need like almost these sequential steps. Okay, so yeah, so why is this a proof of sequential work, or you know, how we like to call it maybe verifiable delay algorithm, because for non-theoreticians this is kind of more descriptive of what this thing does. Again, if you kind of equate sequential computation with the time that has passed, this is kind of a proof. So if you generate such a proof, this is kind of a proof that you have spent, you know, t time on top after receiving the statement chi. Okay. So there are several issues with the original construction of Mahmoudi et al. The first two here are based are kind of a result of the fact that they use this fancy combinatorial object that we have heard about this morning already, namely depth robust graphs. So one problem is the space complexity of the prover. The prover not only needs t sequential time to compute the proof, he also needs space at the limit, which can be massive. Okay, another problem is that because this is depth robust graphs, kind of the parameters, it was not really clear what the parameters really are, they were not particularly good, and yeah. And a third problem that is only a problem for our application that I will mention later, but it was not a problem for them, is uniqueness. So once the prover really spends t sequential time to come up with a proof, he can generate a million different proofs, accepting proofs, that, you know, accepting proofs. So it's kind of not, there is no canonical representation of the proof. That this was not a problem for their application to non-interactive time stamping, but for us. So the new construction that I will show you solves problem 1 and 2, but not 3. First of all, in times of space, we need logarithmic space. To linear, so for example, if t is 2 to the 42, that's like 10 orders of magnitude, right? Instead of petabytes, the prover can only take kilobytes. It's a significant improvement. And I will show you the construction, it's super simple, the very, you know, no hidden constants, no nothing. And finally, the uniqueness problem is something that we really would like to have solved, and it's like a really nice problem. So, can you come up with such a unique publicly verified proof of sequential work, and you know, without using I/O or SNARK, like basic object, or as simple as that. Okay, so construction and proof sketch. Okay, so I will use three basic concepts. So the first one, I will only use it to explain the MMP construction, and you've again already heard about this thing, so depth robust graphs. So a depth robust graph is a DAG directed acyclic graph. And we say that this DAG is ED depth robust if the following is true. If removing any E nodes from that DAG, there remains a path of length D. And they claim that this particular DAG here is 2-3 depth robust. So for example, if you remove those two nodes, there is still a path of length 3 left. And you can, you know, for this point example, you can brute force it and check that this is true for every two nodes. So this is a 2-3 depth robust. And for the rest of the talk, if I say depth robust graph, I mean just a graph, depth robust graph with very high E and D. You think of E and D being like linearly, like 0, 1, or something. Another concept is graph labeling. So if you give me a directed acyclic graph and some hash function H, I define the labeling of the vertices as follows. So the label of the sources is simply the hash of whatever, some dummy element, and more generally, the label of any node is defined as the hash of the labels of its parents. Right? So if you need that, you can just compute in time, you know, linear the number of nodes, this label. And the third concept that I would like to introduce is sequentiality. So, and the fact that random oracles are sequential. So assume, you know, there's this random oracle, and I made two, some adversary made two queries. So query X that resulted in a 256 bit output Y, and some other query X prime that resulted in an output Y prime. Now, if this Y is a proper in like a substring of this X prime, so like this 256 consecutive bits appear also in the output of X prime, then I will conclude that almost certainly this query X prime has been made after the query X. Right? And you can really show in the random oracle that this is going to be true. And if you want a standard model assumption, we will call it hash function sequential if this is also true, you know, or well reported. Okay, so how does the MMP construction look like? So you know, that's the first message as before. So the verifier sends some random points to the prover and some time parameter, let's say 6. And here's what the prover does. First of all, the protocol for any possible time parameter will specify some DAG. So if the parameter is 6, the protocol will say, oh, use this particular DAG. And these random coins here are just used to sample the fresh random oracle. So we've heard the talk, so Corretti and so on, the talk this morning, showed us that, you know, if you just use this random coins as a prefix to every query, this random oracle H chi will behave like a function. Okay? And then, not surprisingly, what the prover does is he computes labeling of this tag, and and then he computes the Merkle tree commitment of all these labels. Actually, he will compute the Merkle tree commitment in parallel as he kind of computes labels of the tags. So he really is finished after t sequential steps with parallelism 2, so he makes like 2 queries per round. And then he sends his commitment here over to the proof. Okay, then comes another phase, like a challenge response phase, where the verifier challenges the prover to open a subset of the nodes. And the verifier, the prover simply opens these nodes together with the parent, and the verifier checks that, you know, all the openings are correct and that all the labels are really the hash of the labels of the parent. And yeah, now this is not what I promised you before. I promised you like a two message protocol, but of course, no. This is again the public coin phase. So this challenge is a public coin, so you can just use fiat channeling to get like a 2-round public coin protocol if you want. Okay. That's the MMP construction. Okay, here is a proof sketch, how they proved that this is really proof of sequential work. They said, okay, assume this G is really the defer-loss. And assume, consider the time point phi, where the prover, like non-malicious prover P tilde, has set this commitment over to the verifier. At this point, the prover is committed to these labels at one prime, not two prime, and so on. So there are some values possibly empty, but he will only be able to open the commitment. Now, let's say that the label is bad if its hash is not the, the label is bad if the hash of its, of the labels the prover is committed to of the parents does not give that label. So basically this means it's, a label is bad if me as a prover, I've opened the label and the parents and hashed them to the verifier and check that something fishy is going on. So then we make a case analysis. Assume there are lots of bad labels, then the verifier will catch the prover. You remember he asked them to open some of the nodes, he will catch the type of them. Case two, there are few bad labels, and with few I mean less than E, where E is, you know, this E depth process. But if there are less than E bad labels, there, by definition, there exists a path going through, in the graph, if I remove these bad labels, there exists a path of length D going through all the remaining labels. And by the sequentiality of the random oracle, I conclude that the prover must have made at least D sequential queries prior to, you know, computing this commitment phi. And if D is kind of not too far away from T, that's kind of the soundest property we would like to prove. Right? Okay. That was the proof search by MMP. So how does the new construction look like? So the MMP construction is very nice in the sense that it's very modular. It's clear which component has which job, right? So there's this Merkle tree commitment that commits these nodes of this other DAG. This other DAG is dead from us, so it has this property that if I remove nodes, there is this long path, so you know every rule is kind of clearly assigned. So let's forget about that and just consider like do everything in one shot. We just consider like one big graph, actually a very simple graph. Let's start with the tree, like a Merkle tree. So this is going to be this commitment, you know, this will be the nodes of our graph, and it has 50 nodes. Let's add some edges to it. So what edges do we add? For every leaf, for example, this orange leaf here, we consider the path from the leaf to the root. And then we add the edge to this leaf from all its siblings, actually from all its left siblings, right? So this is a leaf, this is a left sibling, this is a left sibling, this is a right sibling. So again, we consider all the nodes that would open in the Merkle tree commitment, the opening of that leaf, and if there are left, if there are left siblings, we add the edge. Why not? Right? And you do that for all the leaves. Then you end up with this graph. Okay? Now, before I tell you something about properties of this graph, the protocol now proceeds basically as an MMP. So the prover computes the labeling of this particular graph, then it sends the label of the root, which kind of functions now like a Merkle tree commitment over to the prover, and then the verifier will challenge the prover to open some leaves, for example this leaf here, and the prover will open this leaf, and what does it mean he opens this leaf? It means he has to give this node, this node, this node. This node he already sent over, and the verifier will first of all, you know, like the Merkle tree commitment, check like all these consistencies of the blue edges that, you know, everything hashes together to that commitment here. But of course, on top of that, he will also check that the parents, so he will hash the parents of that node, and and see if you really guess this particular label. And note that conveniently, all the parents of that node are a subset of the nodes that you have to open anyway if you want to open a merge. So it's not, so the communication complexity is not even bigger than just a standard merge tree opening. The prover has to do a little bit more of hashing, because he has to additionally do this one and hash this. Okay, so this is such a simple construction that it's hard to believe that, and I will show you that there's some very nice properties. It's hard to believe that nobody came up with it before, and actually that's what I thought about a few hours ago, but it turns out, so Barry just told me that at PK, and I looked it up at PKC 2000, they had a paper about timestamping, and they used this basically the same graph for a totally different problem. So basically they used this graph to give certificates where you have you generate the certificates one after the other, and once you have two certificates, you could kind of verify that one certificate was generated after the other, while the certificates were fairly short. So basically, they also had this graph, and they generated the certificates by. So, yeah. Okay. So I haven't read the paper, so I just got that. So here is the proof sketch. So as before, once the prover set this commitment, or you know, this label of the root to the prover is committed to these labels of all these nodes. And again, let's say label I is bad, it's got the hash of, you know, of its parents. So now let's say the prover tried to cheat. What does it mean? He kind of committed to labels where, like, the red ones are not really the hash of the labels of its parents that he committed to. Now, let's define a set S which contains all these bad nodes plus everything below them. So here, this is this bad node, you take everything below. It's not about everything below. He's already in that sense. So here are two claims that are very elementary claims, that are, you know, two line proofs. The first is, I claim that if, you know, no matter what these bad labels are, you define this superset S. I claim that there is a path that is going through all the remaining, through all the nodes that are not in this set S. So in this case, it would be just, you know, this path here. This is the first claim. And the second claim is the probability that if the, so the verifier challenges the prover to open some random leaves. So the probability that on a random leaf the prover will not be able to open correctly is exactly, you know, the fraction of the set S over all nodes. So what does that mean? This means that if you combine these two claims, statement is simply that if the prover cheated, and instead of making t sequential query, he kind of tries to get away with t minus epsilon, epsilon 0 with 1 or something like that, then if he gets later challenged on whatever hundreds of challenges or something like that, we will kind of catch him with probability 0 with 9. So very, you know, very concrete, simple parameters. Okay, that's the construction. Okay, I still have more time than expected. Which means I can actually tell you a bit about the motivation for this work, and this is about the sustainable blockchains. So, I think everybody here knows what Bitcoin is, and everyone knows also what proofs of work are. So you know that Bitcoin, so securing the blockchain underlying Bitcoin is based on these proofs of work, so it was like these gigantic factories that do nothing else than having dedicated hardware for producing these proofs of work. And this is a problem for various reasons. So first of all, it's an ecological problem. But there are some estimates that say that the energy consumption of this Bitcoin mining is comparable to Denmark or some country around that size. Also, the hardware is not useful for anything than Bitcoin mining. So this is also like a waste of this kind of resources. It's an economical problem for the long-term sustainability of the chain, because you really constantly require, you know, miners to dedicate a lot of energy, so they have to be rewarded for that. And these rewards have to come from somewhere, so either the currency will kind of face some significant inflation, or it will have high transaction fees. And Bitcoin actually solves it by having high inflation now and high transaction fees in the future, so it's kind of supposed to shield it. And there are other issues that I don't want to go into, security issues. So the question is, you know, can we have like a more sustainable blockchain? Okay, let's see. We have heard this morning a talk about proof of stake, which is probably the best investigated alternative to proof of work. So the idea would be there that we use basically the currency itself as a resource. That's, you know, if that works out, it's going to be great, but it's really very challenging. So another approach would be to just use another external resource, so not the currency itself, but like a resource that is less wasteful. And you know, if you did, everyone did computational complexity theory knows that the two main resources that we investigate are time and space. So for us, proof of work kind of computational time, let's try to use disk space. And there is an abundance of disk space out there. So many of you have like a laptop, and you probably have like 100 gigabytes of course. Some of you will have a few hundred gigabytes of free disk space. So if you could just use these hundreds of gigabyte disk space basically for mining, this would incur like basically no marginal cost for you. So you could just do that, and if many people do that, there would be lots of dedicated space. Yeah. So, but using space is kind of, you know, less trivial. It's using space instead of proofs of space instead of proofs of work is kind of far from trivial. So let me recap what Bitcoin actually does. Bitcoin uses computational as a resource, and the idea is to basically say that the probability of a miner finding a proof of work first and being able to kind of add a block to the blockchain and just get the block reward and the transaction fees roughly corresponds to its fraction of the total hashing power. And Bitcoin has this nice dynamics that there is this hardness parameter that gets like recalibrated every 2 weeks, so that blocks appear roughly every 10 minutes, right? So if you're a miner, you just sit there and every now and then. So what Gia proposal wants to do is to replace this proofs of work with two proof systems, proofs of space and another proof system, proof of time, proof of sequential work, actually. So if you use space as a resource, or as proofs of space, I haven't defined them, but let me just say this is a proof system where a miner kind of initializes the space, so that takes time, but later if you get a challenge that you really dedicate to that space, everyone can compute a proof that he dedicated that space in the millisecond, like just doing some constant number of constant lists, so super efficient. But this is a problem if you want to use the blockchain, because now suddenly it's not like one person who has a proof of work, shouts up and gives a block, but like everybody has, every miner has a proof. There is a billion proofs. So what we do here is basically assign quality to this proof. So this is an idea that already has been done, for example, in the earlier proposal of space thing. Later it has been referred to as cryptographic self-selection in proof of stake protocols. But basically the idea is you generate a proof, you hash it, or sign it, or so, and you get some kind of number, and this is the quality. And the lower, in our case, the lower this number is you get, the value, the better your quality. And now you get the dynamics, like in Bitcoin, what we will do is we will run the proof of sequential work on top of that proof of space. And the challenge for that, and the time that this proof of work has to run on top of that proof of space to finalize the block and to actually generate the actual block depends exactly on this quality of that proof. So if I can generate proof of space, it has awesome quality, I will announce it, somebody will finalize that block, and that's the kind of work. Okay, so I'm pretty much out of time. So this is my slide. So I think
questions.
So you said that it's a problem that you can generate many different proofs. And can you can comment on that? Why is that a problem for the blockchain, and why in your construction you can generate many different proofs?
Yes. Okay. So as I have this slide anyway. So in Bitcoin, you know, blocks are just, you know, it's a chain of blocks. Every one block contains basically like this this proof of work. So like a seed that hashes to something that, yeah. So a seed, so that yeah. Okay. Now in Gia, what we want to do is we alternate proofs of space and proofs of sequential work. So this is a proof of space, this is a proof of time. And the challenge for that proof of sequential work and also the time it requires is kind of depends on the previous proof of space. And then on top of that, once this thing is finished and somebody announces it, you can put the proof of space on top of that and so on. Now, this chain has absolutely no transactions or nothing, and everything is needs to be totally canonical. So this proof of work has to be a deterministic function of that proof of space. And if you're a miner and you generate a proof of space, you should not be able to fiddle around with it to get many different proofs of space. The only choice you should have is to either announce it or not. And why is it important? It's important because there is something that's called the grinding attack. So where, because the challenge for this thing depends on the previous proof of time, or on the sequential work, if I could, you know, try out a million different choices for that proof, I could pick the one that gives me a very good challenge for my proof of space. Because proof of space is so efficient to compute, if I, you know, I can just locally generate a million different ones, pick the one I like most, and announce that. What?
In your construction, why is it? Why can you generate me?
Oh, why you can do it? So in the construction, the problem is if I just cheat on the single leaf, like this one, right, then it will result in a different commitment. So there will be different proofs. On the other hand, if you just cheat on the single leaf, the probability that, you know, I will fail the verification phase is very slow, it's very low, because it's just kind of something like the number of challenges divided by t. So think of t as 2 to the 30, if there are like 1 or 2 to the... So you see, so I can just locally do little changes. Once I did that proof, I can do... Because it's going to be all Fiat, Shamir, Abt, and so on. Right? So I can do local changes and generate like lots and lots and lots of proofs. So that's why we need this feature.
Okay, so let's take the speaker again.